Good evening, folks. Welcome to Barnes & Noble on the Upper East Side. Glad to see you all here this evening. We're here for a special event with Father John Sheehan, entitled From Broadway to God. We're very pleased to have him here, and I'll just say a few things about Father John. He's a Jesuit priest based in Manhattan and the chairman of the Xavier Society for the Blind, chaplain for the New York Athletic Club, Notre Dame Club of New York, and for the American Legion Post 2001, the 9/11 Memorial Post that meets on the USS Intrepid. He helps out at St. Malachy's, the Actors Chapel, and is a member of Actors Equity, which you'll soon find out. Before coming to the priesthood, he worked for a number of years in professional theater, thus From Broadway to God, and broadcasting and continues to perform and has three CDs available. You'll have noticed, I hope, that there are flyers on the chairs that gives you some information about Father John and indeed the recordings, and I believe they're available tonight as well. So, ladies and gentlemen, without any further ado, I'd like to welcome Father John Sheehan.
Jesuit priest. And probably the question I am most often asked Is God man or a woman?
No, actually, that's not it. I got to ask that a lot before I shave, but after that, people settle down. No, it really is not even so much why did you become a priest, but how did you go from being an actor to being a priest? And so I'm going to try to address that tonight. Now, that first song was from Peter Pan, and it was my first Broadway show. I was born in New York, baptized at St. Patrick's, but we had moved to New Jersey at this point. My parents brought me in, and we went to the matinee. Mary Martin flying through the air, Cyril Richard, oh, it was glorious. And we went back to my grandmother's apartment. She had a place over on Park Avenue. And it was wintertime, so it was kind of dark. And I went off into the side bedroom all by myself, and I cried, and I cried, and I cried. It was like my heart was breaking. Because I had just seen this wonderful, beautiful, magical thing, and I was never going to see it again. And it broke my heart. And that was the night I fell in love with theater. And I was very lucky. I had parents and a grandmother who loved theater, who took me to, and I got to see everything. Music Man, Flower, Drum Song, and one of the great plays of the 50s was, of course, My Fair Lady. And I went to see My Fair Lady. My grandmother had a ticket man, Mr. Jerry. He was a magician. He could get you a ticket to anything. Front row balcony for My Fair Lady, right? In the sixth month of the run. So we're sitting there, and when I went home that night, no tears, a little melancholy maybe, but I was all right. But I wrote notes to everybody. I wrote a note to Julie Andrews and to Rex Harrison and to Stanley Holloway and to Robert Coop, who played Pickering. Well, they all wrote back. It was a time when people were very polite. But Coop wrote back a handwritten note on New York Athletic Club stationery. Well, my grandfather had belonged to the New York Athletic Club. So I wrote Coop back and said, my grandfather, well, he hadn't known him, but he knew people who had known him. And so we kept this correspondence. Well, when Coop came to New York to do King Pellinore in Camelot, he invited me up for a rehearsal. And so I spent the day with Julie Andrews and Richard Burton and Robert Goulet, and that was wonderful. And then in later years, because of that, I got to go out drinking one night with Richard Burton, which is a story for another time. But My Fair Lady was a great, great show. And there was one song in it. I heard it once on the radio, and I just knew it. I never had to study it. I never had to learn the words. It was one of those songs that just resonated with me. And I'm going to sing it tonight, because it's a love song. And guys like me don't get to sing love songs very often. I didn't bring an orchestra tonight, so I've got this little gadget, so I have to look at it every now and then to see what I'm doing. Pardon my back. Pardon my front.
Sorry, little barber.
I have often walked down the street before, but the pavements always stay beneath my feet before. All at once am I several stories high, knowing I am on the street where you live. Are there lilac trees in the heart town? Can you hear a lark in any other part of town? Does enchantment pour out of every door? To Giuseppe Di Luca, when Di Luca was singing at the Metropolitan Opera and then later teaching. And then Charles became a teacher himself. Charles died about a month ago. I had the privilege of saying his funeral mass. And I worked with Charles from 1967 until shortly before he died. And he was very patient. I wasn't very good at the beginning, but we did a lot of work together. And there was one song that was an exercise piece, and we sang it. We sang it, and we sang it, I don't know how many thousand times we sang it. We sang it high, we sang it low, we sang it fast, we sang it slowly, we sang it nasal, we sang it bass, we sang it every which way. You can wake me up at 3 o'clock in the morning and I can sing this song without thinking about it, you know. Charles always took credit for the fact that I ended up as a priest. And I think he thought that the number of times we sang this song might have had something to do with it. So now I'm gonna sing it for you.
Yeah.
school. I've been raised a Catholic altar boy. I can still do the Latin responses, the whole nine yards. When I went to college, I made a discovery. If you did not go to Mass on Sunday morning, nothing happened. You did not get a run of bad luck. You did not get a mark appear on your forehead. Your mother did not suddenly get premonitions and start calling you, wondering what was wrong. Nothing happened. And so for many years, God and I had a very good relationship. I didn't bother him, he didn't bother me. I came to New York to be an actor. And I did that for a while. And I decided that working was better than not working. So unlike some of my contemporaries who refused to leave New York so that they'd be sure to be here when David Merritt called, although he never did, I took work anywhere and pretty much anything. I did dinner theater tours, I did bus and truck tours, I did regional theater, I drove for the Buddy Wagner Hell Drivers, jumping cars off of ramps. Working was better than not working. And at one point I found myself back in South Bend, Indiana, working for a cultural arts and convention center. And I got a job on the side as cantorial soloist in a Jewish temple. For 2.5 years, every Shabbat but two, I was there singing. And I only missed one Shabbat service. There was one Shabbat I'd had root canal and my jaw was frozen shut and I couldn't sing, but by heaven, I was at the temple. It was an eye-opening, life-changing experience. When I first went to see the rabbi, of course, I asked him, wouldn't you rather have somebody who's Jewish singing? He said, to be Jewish would be good, to have a voice is better. He also explained to me that in the Jewish services, unlike many of the Christian services where the music is an accompaniment to what goes on, they have a saying, the rabbi leads the minds to God and the cantor leads the hearts to God. And in the temple, there are two pulpits, two bima, one for the rabbi for preaching and one for the cantor for singing. And it was my time in the temple that brought me back to God. Because I was with a group of people for whom God was an integral part of their lives. It influenced how they raised their children. It influenced how they dealt with one another. We were a Reformed temple, obviously. The organist was a Methodist. I mean, you know, how Reformed can you get? But in our temple, businessmen who had disputes with one another, they solved those disputes not by going to small claims court or calling their attorneys, they called the rabbi. And the rabbi settled their disputes not on the basis of civil law, but on the basis of Torah and Talmud. And they agreed to this ahead of time. And this touched me. This said something to me about what I was missing in my life. And this is one of the prayers that is said or sung at every Shabbat service all over the world.
Shalom.
I learned a lot of things at the temple. I learned a lot of music that wasn't necessarily related to the temple. I went home the first Christmas and my parents were fascinated that I was singing in the Jewish temple. One of the songs I had learned was a Jewish lullaby, Laila, Laila. And I sang it. My mother got this look on her face. And I thought maybe I'd done something to offend her. Well, it turned out that my grandfather, who had died in 1949, so I had only a very faint memory of him, had sung that lullaby to me when I was first born. Now, how my Episcopalian grandfather had come to know this Jewish lullaby, no one ever found out. But it sort of tied things together. Another thing I learned, of course, about the Jewish community was they are great storytellers. Everything becomes a story. And I had some German. I did one of my university years at the University of Innsbruck. So I had German. And so with the German and a little bit of Hebrew from the temple, suddenly I realized I knew a little bit of Yiddish. And when you know a little bit of Yiddish, everything opens up for you. This is a story. And there are some Yiddish words in it. But when we come along to them, I will explain when we get there. The one word you have to know when we start out and understand this story is the Yiddish word miskeit. Now, miskeit means ugly, funny looking. Miskeit means miskeit, miskeit. Once upon a time there was a miskeit, miskeit. Looking in the mirror, he would say, "What an awful shock. I got a face that would stop a clock." Miskeit, miskeit, such a pity on him, he's a miskeit, miskeit. God up in his heaven put him out on a shaking limb. He put a miskeit on him. Well, he got a little bigger, huh? And soon in the cheder, means Hebrew school, he sat beside a little girl. And when he asked her her name, she replied, "I'm Pale." He ran to the tzeder, means grandfather, and said in that screechy voice of his, "You told me I was the homeliest. Well, Gramps, you're wrong. Pile is." Miskeit, miskeit, never did I saw a bigger miskeit, miskeit, everywhere a flaw. And maybe that is the reason why I'm gonna love her until I die. Miskeit, miskeit, isn't it a pleasure? She's a miskeit, miskeit. She's the one I treasure, for I thought there could never be a bigger miskeit than me. But they grew up, huh? Even miskeits grew up. And soon they were married. And in a year she turned and smiled. "I'm afraid I am going to have a child." 9 months she carried, worrying how this child would look. And all the relatives worried too. But what a time fate took. Gorgeous, gorgeous. They produced a baby that was gorgeous, gorgeous. Crowding round the cradle, all the relatives awed and oohed. She ought to pose for a baby food. Gorgeous, gorgeous, would I tell a lie? She's simply gorgeous, gorgeous. Who'd have ever thought that we would see such a flawless gem out of two miskites like them? No, no, wait, 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 there's a moral, huh? Okay. All my stories have a moral.
You're
moral, moral. Yes, indeed, the story has a moral, moral. Though you may be homely, it is nevertheless quite true. There may be beautiful things in you. Miskeit, miskeit, listen to the fable of the miskeit. Miskeit, anyone responsible for loveliness, large or small, is not a miskeit at all. Well, when I left Indiana, Pittsburgh and worked with the Pittsburgh Public Theater for a while. And then I came back to New York. I was looking for my next job. And I was being interviewed for a job in theater administration out in California. And they had rented offices in New York to do the interviews. And you know, sometimes you click with people and you just know this job was mine. I had it. I'd been back two or three times. I passed one big hurdle. They'd given me a set of financial statements and said, all right, take a look at these, and if you have any questions, come back for one more interview and we'll talk about it and we'll go for that. Something in the way they said that made me suspicious, so I really unpacked the financial statements. Well, I went back for the next meeting. They said, well, do you have any questions? I said, yeah. I said, who is your accountant? Because either he does not know what he is doing or he is robbing you blind. And they said, what do you mean? And I explained all of the problems that I saw in the financial statement. They said, okay, thank you very much. It was a dummy. They had rigged it to find out if the candidates would actually study it and know what they were reading. So they were going to fly me out to California to meet the board of directors, right? This job is mine. I left them. I went down. And I can show you the spot, Broadway between 43rd and 44th Street. I got there and I realized I wasn't excited. Now, if you had asked me to describe the perfect job for me at that point in my life, other than starring in a Broadway show, but realistically, that would have been it. And I thought about it for a day or two, and I called them up, and I said, you know, I think maybe I apologize, but I would like not to be considered for this job anymore. They immediately offered me $5,000 a year more. Now, they had not offered me a job, thank you, but they're upping the ante. And I said, no, it's not the money. And they said, well, what is it? I wasn't excited, and I should have been. So I said, all right, if that's not it, then what is? What makes me excited? What is important in my life? What is it that I want to do? What's it all about? I guess it was a midlife crisis, I don't know. Well, when you start asking yourself life questions like that, pretty soon the God question is going to raise its ugly head. Do you believe in God? Now, I was rooting for a no. I figured my life would be a lot easier if I could do away with this whole God thing once. God is inescapable. All right, what about being a Jew? I had a standing offer from the people at the temple. They would send me to cantorial school for 4 years and get my degree, pay all of my expenses. Why not be a Jew? Other than the fact that my father would have killed me. Why not be a Jew? Well, Jesus Christ was inescapable. I couldn't get around it. So there I was. I'm a Christian. Now that's kind of a surprise, you know, late in life. I was in my early 30s at that point. But there I was a Christian. So I started going back to church, and I rather liked it. And I started praying, and that wasn't painful, and life went on. I wasn't working a lot, but I don't think those two things were connected. And then this notion of priesthood started raising its ugly head. And you know, I don't know if they still have them, but on the boardwalk they used to have these games where the little gophers would pop their heads up at, and you'd hit them with the hammer, you know. But that was what my life was like. Priesthood, thunk. Priesthood, thunk. Priesthood, go away! You know, I had owned a house, I had a very nice car, I had discovered women sometime before, thank you very much. You know, I get it! And this thing kept coming up and coming up. And it would not go away. And I made long lists of why it was a good idea to be a priest and why it was a good idea not to be a priest and why it was a bad idea to be a priest and why it was a bad idea. And I was tying myself up in knots. And one day I remembered I had read somewhere, if you're facing a decision and you really can't go A or B, pick one. Doesn't matter, pick one and see what it feels like. So, and again, I can tell you the day, I can show you the chair I was sitting in. I said, all right, I give up. And it's interesting, isn't it? That was the phrase I used, I give up. I give up, I'll be a priest. I got a sense of peace that has stayed with me ever since. Good times and bad, and there were bad times. And so then, I went to the Jesuits. Why the Jesuits? I have no idea.
I was a good guy.
I only knew one Jesuit that knew me back. It was like one of those things. And actually, you know, I'd gone through my first interview and I prepared. I tried to anticipate the questions he was going to ask, and I knew I could talk about my prayer life and my history and all of this. And his first question is, why the Jesuits? I don't know. You know. And I had a strange resume. A theater person in those days would have looked at my resume and gone, wow, great experience. A businessman would look at my resume and go, can't keep a job. Jesuits in those days were more businessmen than theater people, and they, you know, they had the same reaction as many of my friends. You want to be a priest? But after a lot of interviews and psychological testing and going around, they accepted me. and I entered the novitiate. I was 33 when I entered the novitiate. It's a little old for entering a novitiate, but they took me. And it was easy. It was comfortable. It was relaxed. I had spent the 6 months prior to entry giving things away. I felt like Santa Claus. I had more fun. It was really easy, and it was a great time in my life. And surprise, there's even a song that goes along with it.
Well, I thought there was a song that went along with it.
I had not shaved since 1986, so it was a while. I discovered my laundry is getting harder to do. Well, there's food. You know, if you drop something, it never got anywhere. It sort of stopped right here. Now all of a sudden, I've got ties and shirts and things. And I want to tell you, weather like this, you walk out the door, boy, I miss my beard. People don't stand up and give me a seat on the bus anymore. And in this neighborhood, of course, with my black coat and my big hat and my big full beard, everybody spoke to me in Hebrew. It was very friendly. I was in Lagos, Nigeria for 12 years. That was my first assignment as a priest. And I had the big full beard. And in Lagos, they have these traffic jams that go on for hours and hours and hours. And so there are hawkers, sellers, going up and down in between the cars, selling everything. Raw meat and telephone parts and food and games and small children. I mean, it's amazing. You can buy anything there. So this was before Christmas one year. And to help us get through the police checks, the cars always had painted on the side of them, Jesuit Fathers and Brothers, Society of Jesus. So this hawker comes up to me and he says, Master, buy aftershave, buy aftershave. Now I've got this big full beard. I look at him and I say, my friend, where would I put it? He said, eh? Oh, okay. Buy perfume for wife. And I said, my friend, I have no wife. No wife? No, I am a reverend father. Reverend father? Yes, the Holy Father, the Pope, does not allow me to have a wife. Ah, reverend father. Yes, reverend father. No wife. Buy for girlfriend. I wanted to ask him what parish he went to, but the traffic moved on and we went away. Beards are useful for a lot of things. And one of them is that there are some roles in theater that are really for people with beards, and Fiddler on the Roof is one. I did 3 tours of Fiddler on the Roof. In each tour, I understudied Tevye. Never got to go on. Such a healthy bunch of Tevyes you've never seen in your life. You know, you'd think just as a courtesy, they would, no. So, the song, of course, anywhere you go, they say, oh, please sing If I Were a Rich Man. And so that's my bow to the vow of poverty that we take as Jesuits, anybody in a religious order does. It's not a hard violin. Of the three, it's probably, at least for me, it's the easiest. Everything is in community. If you walk up to me after this show and you say, oh, this is so great, here's a check for $5,000, and please feel free to do that. I would say thank you very much, and I would take it home, and I would either give it to my rector for the community, or I would ask permission to give it to the Xavier Society for the Blind. I don't get to keep it. I don't own anything. This ring is my Notre Dame class ring, and it belongs to the Society of Jesus. Anything I need, I get from the Jesuits. Anything that I get belongs to the community. And it's actually fairly easy to live. That's not a hard one. Listen to this song from Fiddler on the Roof. Tevye is sharing the same dream that everybody has. If I were a rich man, I would build this, I would buy that, I would do. But at the very end, the thing that is most important to him, if he has the money, he could sit in the temple and pray and study the holy books. That's the thing that the money would do for him more than anything else. Are you ready?
Okay.
If I were a rich man, if I were a wealthy man, I would have to work hard all day long. If I were a decent titled man, I'd build a big tall house with rooms by a dozen, right in the middle of the town. A great tin roof with real wooden floors below. There would be one long staircase just going up, and one even longer coming down, and one more going nowhere, just for sure. I'd fill my yard with chicks, turkeys, geese, ducks for the town to see and hear, squawking just as noisily as they can. And each loud man, man, bar, would land like a trumpet on the ear, as if to say he lives a wealthy man. Oh, if I were a rich man, I'm
if I were a wealthy man.
I wouldn't have to look up.
With a proper double chin. Supervising, yes, our delight. I'd see her putting on airs,
strutting like a peacock. Boy, what a happy mood she's in!
Screaming at the servants day and night. The most important men in town will come down.
That we had given up women and family made a real impact on them. Now, there are a lot of love songs, and there are, unfortunately, I guess, an increasing number of songs about sex. There aren't a lot of songs about chastity, I want to tell you. But I found one, sort of, celibacy. It's from the musical Green Willow. And actually, the first time I heard it, Richard Tucker was singing it. And sometime I'll tell you the story of how I got to know him.
Many flimsy gems in looking for true love. Better sign me no good dearie good day. Many flimsy gems in looking for true love. Better look a looking some other way. And be known nevermore, promise. But a fancy dancy fiddle and free. Any flimsy timsy looking for true love. But a waste. Or acquaintances, please let them know about us.
If you have friends with money, please let them know about us. If you would like to be on our mailing list, we have a sign-up sheet on your way out. You can jot down your name, and if it's just email, we have an e-newsletter that goes out. We are, among other things, a recognized charity of the National Football League, the NFL, and each year we get to take part in the NFL Super Bowl raffle. We have 250 tickets for the raffle. They're $100 a piece. And first prize is two tickets to the Super Bowl in Dallas this year, and airfare down and back, and four nights in a hotel, and two tickets to the NFL Hall of Fame alumni dinner, which is the night before the game, and there's at least one Hall of Fame player at every table. Now, if you're a football fan, this is a big deal. And there are only 250 tickets. Second prize is $1,000, third prize is $500. Now, I'm no statistician, but it seems to me you got a 3 in 250 shot, you're going to win something. We have three tickets left. And the gentleman back here with the coat and very little hair on top of his head is the one you would see if you would like to commit yourself to one of these three tickets. We are hoping to sell them today and tomorrow, and then we'll do the raffle draw and the winners can start planning their trip. Several years ago, when the Giants won the Super Bowl and the game was played in Arizona, the people from our group who won, being from New York, the NFL folks came up and took them on the field. They were with the team 3 minutes after the game ended. You're not just at the Super Bowl, you're at the Super Bowl as the guest of the NFL. So there's that commercial. We have, I have three CDs out. We do not have them here, unfortunately. We're in the process of redoing the covers, but you can order them online. And they're really neat. One is called Father John Sings Sacred Songs. One is The Several Sides of Father John. And the third is Father John Live in Concert. When I was in Nigeria, I was doing a lot of concerts going around. And I had a sound guy who, unbeknownst to me, recorded everything I did. And so just before I left Nigeria, we put them all together into a CD. When I issued the first two CDs, I sent copies to my sister. I was still in Nigeria, she was in the States. And after a while, I got a note from her. She said, oh, I've got the CDs and they're wonderful. Thank you very much. She said, I've wanted something like this for a long time. She said, now I can turn you off. Sisters. Is that everything? Oh, new CDs. We have just issued a new CD, and we do have some of those here. And Barnes & Noble has very graciously said that they'll look the other way if we want to sell them. They're $15 a piece, two for $25, and they are Latin Christmas carols. They are Christmas carols sung in Latin. All of them are sung in Latin. Some of the traditional ones, like Adeste Fidelis and Personet Hodie, but also Frosty the Snowman and...
Feliz Navidad.
No, we don't.
Rudolph.
That's a different Latin.
Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
Rudolph we do. Frosty the Snowman we do.
Jingle Bells.
Die Christian Sonio. I sing. We've got a really good soprano, Christina Holmes, who sings. Bill Wurzel's on the guitar, Woody Regan is on the piano, and the daughter of our executive director pops in every now and then with a cello. It's kind of fun, and we have included words, so if you want to sing along with the Latin, they're in there. And we have some of those. And Christine would be the one. We also have calendars, and they're free. Xavier Society, they just came today, fresh from the printers. So if you would like a calendar, please take one. Oops, I better keep moving. Let's see, I've done poverty and I've done chastity, obedience. That's the hard one. It really is. That's the hard one, because the idea behind obedience is you are trusting that God's will is being reflected in what your superior tells you to do. Shortly before I was ordained, I had a meeting with my provincial, the boss, right? And in our hierarchy, you've got a local superior who reports to the provincial, who reports to Father General in Rome, who reports to the Pope. So it's not a very big chain of command here. You know, you're like four steps away from the Pope. And the conversation topic was, well, what are you going to do after ordination? And I had several suggestions, and he hated all of them. And at one point in the conversation, I said, look, Joe, I want to be really clear about this. I am not volunteering for the missions. But, I says, and that but will get you every time. But, I says, if you had something that really called upon my training and my experience, I think what's happening in Africa is so important that I couldn't say no. 6 weeks later, I'm going to Kaduna in northern Nigeria. I stayed in Kaduna for 26 days. They moved all of the Jesuits out. I was back in Lagos. nothing to do. Nobody knew what to do with me. You know, no job, no. So I tried to make myself useful. By the time I left, I was the assistant to the regional superior, the director of development, the communications coordinator, and the regional treasurer. Tell me God does not have a sense of humor. I was there for 12 years. I went to Micronesia for 3 years, almost 3 years, not quite 3 years. I came back to New York and I thought, fine, third assistant somewhere, nice, relaxing job. The guy who was head of the Xavier Society for the Blind dropped dead. And the provincial, he walked out the door and hit the ground. And the provincial said, go down and take a look at this place. Here I am. Obedience. You do what you're told to do because the will of God is in there somewhere. And I have to say, every time, it's worked out. Brilliantly, it's worked out. Now, there aren't a lot of songs about obedience necessarily, but when you think of the variety of things that you get to do as a Jesuit, the variety of things that you have to be open to for the vow of obedience, this is a song about a guy who has that kind of a life. Now, he has no vow of obedience, and he's not particularly moral, but he does a lot of different stuff. And he's very active in the community in a lot of different ways. He passes notes, he arranges romances, he takes care of all sorts of things. You know this song, and if you'd like to sing along at the end of it, feel free. I sang this in a bar once. The guy said, opera? I said, just think Bugs Bunny.
Figaro!
of the things about God is God speaks in lots of different ways and lots of different voices. One of the fun things about music and theater is you get to speak in lots of different voices. And one of the things that I have noticed, and I'll talk more about this in a second, is if you start looking at things, trying to find God in them. St. Ignatius, who founded the Jesuits, had a saying, find God in all things. And it's surprising where you find God. If you go back and think about the songs that you've heard tonight, God's in all of them. This is one of my favorite, one of my first job when I came to New York, to be an actor, was singing Gilbert and Sullivan for the Light Opera Manhattan. And I love Gilbert and Sullivan because, well, this is not the body of a lover or a hero. Gilbert and Sullivan has lots of roles for funny little men, or funny larger men, yes. You know. And so there's always something for me to do in the Gilbert and Sullivan opera.
In a tree by a river, a little tomtit sang willow, tit willow, tit willow. And I said to him, titty bird, why do you sit singing willow, tit willow, tit willow? Is it weakness of intellect, birdie, I cried, or a rather tough worm on your little inside? With a shake of his poor little head, he replied, oh, willow, tit willow, tit willow. It's really a very sad song. Well, he slapped at his chest as he sat on that bough, singing willow, tit willow, tit willow. And the cold perspiration bespangled his brow. Oh, willow, tit willow, tit willow. He sobbed and he sighed, and a gurgle he gave, and he plunged himself into the billowy wave, and an echo arose from that suicide's grave. Oh, willow, tit willow, tit willow. I knew the bird myself. Now I feel just as sure as I'm sure as me name isn't willow, tit willow, tit willow. That was blighted affection that made him exclaim, ah, willow, tit willow, tit willow. And if you remain callous and obdurate, I shall perish as he did, and you will know why. Though I probably shall not exclaim as I die, oh, willow, tit willow, tit willow.
Shortly before I was ordained, I was still in training. I was out one night with some friends who were mostly theater people, and one of them said to me, John, you know, I think what you're doing is wonderful. He said, but how can you give up theater? And before I could say anything, another friend of mine spoke up and said, oh, John's not giving it up. He's just moving to another branch. Well, you know, that's not bad. Church at its best ought to be able to do what theater at its best does. Tell stories, touch hearts, make people feel welcome, change lives. I spoke a minute ago about the change in perception that can sometimes happen. And I've had a lot of fun looking at songs, especially from Broadway shows, and rethinking them so that if you take a love song, for instance, it may have been written as a love song about man and woman. Make it a song about God and see what the words do. This song is from a show by Andrew Lloyd Webber called Aspects of Love. Brilliant score, wonderful script, totally amoral. I mean, you just leave your ethics at the door, thank you very much. And this song is one of the prime examples of what can happen if instead of thinking man-woman love or man-man love or woman-woman love or what, think God when you hear these words.
Love, love changes everything, hands and faces, earth and sky. Love, love changes everything, how we live and how we die. Love can make a summer fly, or a night seem like a lifetime. Yes, love, love changes everything. Now I tremble at your name. Theater,
for what finally brought me back to God and to a point in my life where I have a closet full of lexins. Tell me God doesn't have a sense of humor.
I know a place where dreams are born and time is never planned. It's not on any chart. You must find it in your heart. Never, never land. It might be miles beyond the moon, or right there where you stand. Just keep an open mind, and then suddenly you'll find. Never, never land. You'll have a treasure if you stay there, precious nor far than gold, for once you have found your way there, you may never, never grow old. So come with me where dreams are born and time is never planned. Just think of lovely things, and your heart will fly on wings forever in
Neverland. God bless you, and good night.